Hey everybody, this is Michael again, and welcome back to my channel here on YouTube. Well guys, actually getting to watch quite a few films here lately. I had gotten so far behind, heck, I'm still behind, guys. There's many films that I wanted to see in 2014, and still quite a few films I want to see this year. But things have slowed down a little bit, guys. I mean, just a little bit. And I'm getting to watch some of the movies that I was interested in seeing, and tonight's film is another of those movies. It's called Late Phases, and I think the only time I really got to see anything about this film was actually online, where I saw the trailer and I thought it was interesting. Now, of course, guys, it's a werewolf story, and I thought it was interesting because of just the premise of the film. You know, there's been a ton of werewolf films, you know, and you gotta wonder, as time passes by, how different can you make a werewolf film? Same goes for a vampire film, a Frankenstein film. You know, it's just so much you can do. But I thought this one had kind of a unique premise, guys, where you have the lead character in the film. He's not only a Vietnam veteran, but he's also blind. And he is the one that has to deal with these werewolves, guys. And as far as the story goes, guys, you have this older gentleman moving into this retirement community. As a matter of fact, according to the story, his wife has recently passed. He has a son who has a wife. And I'm assuming that in the film that his son is the only family that he has. But he moves into the retirement community, and his only companion really is his seeing eye dog named Shadow. And it's kind of funny, guys. I can remember the name of the dog, but I can't remember the name of the people. But anyway, what is that? Is that normal? But anyway, so he moves in. He's kind of estranged from his son. I mean, they talk and they kind of get along, but their relationship is kind of rocky. He's really kind of a gruff sort of character. As a matter of fact, if I was to think about another character that I would compare him to, would probably be Clint Eastwood in Gran Torino. He's kind of like that character. He's hard to get along with. He's kind of racy in his ways. He's just a kind of a bitter character, but he's one of those kind of characters that says what's on his mind. He doesn't play around. He doesn't mince words. He just says what he wants to say. So he moves in to the retirement community, and you know, he's blind. He's kind of setting up his house to get used to everything. He has this dog to lead him around, and you have three older ladies. And this whole community is of course older people, and these three older ladies come in and welcome him to the retirement center or the community, and he pretty much shuns them away. You know, they learn very quickly that, you know, he doesn't really want any company, he doesn't really want any welcome, and you know, he kind of views it as, you know, I'm not here to retire, this is where people go to die. So the first night that he's there, his home is kind of like adjacent to someone else's living center. I mean, you can go to the wall and you can hear sort of what's going on in the other apartment. So that's how close he is to his next door neighbor, which is a really nice lady. So he hears this growling sound, and since he's blind, he's got heightened senses. He can hear a little bit better and he can smell better than someone with sight. So he hears this growling sound and he's like, what the hell is that? I've never heard that before. So he hears it next door. So he goes over to the wall, makes his way to the wall, and he puts his ear up against the wall, and he hears this grumbling and growling, this lady screaming, and he's just kind of like, you know, flabbergasted, caught off guard, wondering what's going on. And, you know, he's beating on the wall. Are you all right? Are you all right? You need help? And next thing you know, the damn werewolf comes crashing through the damn wall, knocks him to the ground, and is about to kill him. But luckily for him, his faithful dog Shadow jumps in front of, or between him and the werewolf, and attacks the werewolf. Now, Shadow ends up getting killed, but he does drive off the werewolf. And he loses his dog. And right at that moment, he realizes that this is some sort of creature. He believes that it's a werewolf because of the growling noises. And he begins an investigation in this small community to figure out who's the werewolf and how he's going to kill this creature. And he really wants revenge against the creature for killing his dog. His dog was his companion. His dog was his closest friend. So that's pretty much the basis of the story. You have this character going to church. Excuse me. You have this character going to church to meet the rest of the community, trying to figure out who's this werewolf. He's going by what he smelled at the time of the murder. And I don't want to give any more of it away, guys, but the film isn't one of those movies that really mince words either. As a matter of fact, you learn who the werewolf is halfway through the film, and it's not really too much of a secret. Although, you know, we learn, and the character pretty much figures it out also, who's the creature. But during the entire film, you know, he pretty much alienates himself from everybody in the community. As a matter of fact, you know, at one time in the film, a church bus is coming to pick him up and take him to church. But the people on the church bus, don't even want him on the bus because he's just so cantankerous that he just, you know, has to be picked up by someone else. Also in this film, guys, I got to say that, where is it? The lead character, I had never seen him in the film, although I think I've may have watched him in a film. He's not really an old character, he's an actor in old age makeup. And, you know, right off the bat, I would think, why would you get an old character or a young actor to play an old character? Just get an old actor. But, you know, his name is Nick Damici. And he does a great job playing this older age character. He just pulls it off. He's pretty much the heart of the story. I mean, he holds it all together. And what surprised me about this film was that the guy that played Kane in RoboCop 2, he plays a priest in the film. And what is his name? Tom Noonan. He plays a priest in the film. And even more surprisingly, guys, we have the lady that played Ginger Grant, the movie star in Gilligan's Island, playing one of the community people in the film as well. As I often say, guys, right off the bat, I gotta say that this was a film that, you know, first I gotta praise it for its practical effects. There are practical effects throughout the entire film. You know, there's no CGI as far as I could see or recognize. The werewolves are done totally practical, men in suits. The morph into the werewolf is done totally practical, almost like Rick Baker's An American Werewolf in London, although not nowhere near as good as that film. You can tell from watching that it's a low-budget film, but you also got to give them props for, you know, trying to stay practical. With that said, I did like the film. It does move at a slow pace, guys, I got to tell you. I mean, you're dealing with a character who is blind, so the investigation is not quite as fluid or as fast as what you would find in another film. But I got to say that this lead character definitely holds this film together, keeps it interesting, and you have some quirky characters in this community, and it's not, you know, it's not quite, or I wouldn't even say quite, it's nowhere near on the level of the 80s horror films where there's like a level of fun and really colorful characters and all that, because it's more laid back. That it's almost like a drama when you watch this film. It starts out as a drama, and it's a film that probably takes itself a little bit too seriously. And the lead character, I enjoyed the way the character was played, how it was portrayed, but I could see it kind of rubbing people the wrong way because there's not too many, he's just a grouchy old man, more or less, who's just, you know, he's got his quips, and he's not quite the character that, you know, is set up to be just totally likable. But you got to admire the guy for just speaking his mind and being the way he is, even if you don't agree that he's the nicest character in the world. But I will say, guys, that I like the character. I didn't really have a problem with his ways. You know, I mean, he's one of those characters that had a bad time in Vietnam. He lost his eyesight. There was a situation where a little kid was coming to their unit. He was strapped with explosives, and he had to take the shot and take the kid out. So there's a lot of guilt there involved in his life, and there's some definite parallels to almost Gran Torino between these two characters. But I felt the film was interesting all the way through. But, you know, it's also another film that I gotta recommend the film, but I can't say that a lot of you may like it because it just may be a little bit too slow for your taste. And I mean, and then you gotta buy the whole thing of actually, could a blind person actually deal with werewolves and defeat these werewolves and all this, because there's several werewolves in the film. So I would recommend you give it a shot. I'm not going to say that it would probably be to your liking, because lots of you may think that it's just totally kind of quirky and off the wall, and you know, oh, this is, no, werewolf, heightened senses, and a blind man can beat him, because he does beat all the werewolves in the film. But I like the film because I thought it was different. It was a different take on a werewolf film. It was nice to see a blind guy deal with the werewolves and dispatch the werewolves. I thought the acting was really good in the film. I just liked it because it was kind of a different take on the werewolf film. It's like I said, how many werewolf films can you do and make them different? And this one at least tried to be different. They tried to use, or they did use, practical effects, and it didn't have a whole lot of now criticisms I would have is that the werewolves themselves, the practical effects, like I said, this film is years and years later after American Werewolf in London, but the effects are nowhere near on par with those films. And the werewolves look really strange, almost comical in the way that they look. They look more like maybe trolls or gremlins or something, but or a mixture of both. They look really odd. But overall, I like the film, guys. I thought that, like I said, a different take. I can't say it was a fun movie because fun really doesn't come to mind, but it was a movie that held my attention and kept me watching it. Now, would I want to watch the film again? I probably want to watch it again just to see the performances by the lead actors and all. So, you know, I enjoyed the film. It's one of those movies where I would say that, once again, it's a decent time waster. Not a time waster, but it's a decent time waster. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody, and I shall see you at the next movie review.